second video under special functions. So in this section we'll be looking at the this form of a quadratic function instead of the general form of quadratic function. So in the previous video you saw that when the generally the quadratic function is given in this form, x squared plus bx plus c, this is the most general representation of a quadratic function. So in this case you saw that when a and c changes, you can actually predict how the function looks like, the shape of the function, how it shifts vertically and all. But when b comes into play, you know that the location of the function, shape, not the shape, actually the location of the function and the number of roots will change, and it's quite difficult to imagine how that that changes with respect to b. So instead of using this general form, we're going to look at this form instead. This is called the completing square. It is obtained by using completing square method. I think you are already familiar with that method. So instead of this general form, it is quite easier to deal with this form obtained by completing square method. Okay, so we'll look at how we obtain this form, the completing square method, using completing square method from the most general case later. But first we'll look at how we deal with this function. So how do you draw a plot a graph, quadratic function in the Cartesian coordinate plane when you are given the quadratic function in this form? Okay, like we discussed, I think you need to know at most 4 points in order to sketch a quadratic function, because in advanced level you are mostly asked to sketch a function. So you in general when a is a positive value, a or the coefficient of x squared is positive, you know that you will get a minimum function, which means the y value take a minimum. So in this case you need to know these 5 points. This is called the minimum point or the turning point, or sometimes it's called vertex as well. And in general you will need to know these 2 points where the x-axis is cut by the function. These are called roots of the function. And sometimes you will have to know what the intercept of this function is. In general, when it is given ax squared plus bx plus c, this c here will be the value at here, right? So if we are given this form, you know that c is related to this form, but you have to take the roots as well. You are already familiar with the formula in order to obtain the roots of a quadratic equation, so you can use that. So the problem here is with this general form is that it's quite difficult to obtain this minimum point, the coordinate of the minimum point or the coordinate of the vertex. So you know that every coordinate is given in this form x and y. So we'll look at how to obtain this vertex. Right. So when the function is given in this form, so what is the minimum value that you can check? You can obtain for this y minimum. What is the minimum? You can see here this expression will yield you a positive value. It will always yield you a positive value because it is a squared term. So what is the minimum it can take? The minimum it can take will be 0. Now when that happens, this will become 0. This expression will become 0 when x plus h equals to 0. When x plus h equals to 0, this expression will become 0, which means x, when x is at minus h. Right. So what you are left with, you know the x terms only included into this expression, and outside we have d. So the minimum value for y will be d, and when that happens, when x equals to, here it should be x is at minus h, right? So the turning point here is P. For the turning point, you have write the x value of the turning point. This would be minus h. So what is the minimum value? Minimum value would be t. Right. So the depending on the sign of t, you will see that the number of roots will change. Whether you have two roots or just a coincident root or no roots at all. Right. So we'll look at it now. You can see here that the minimum value that y can take is positive. Right. So if d is positive in this case, that means y should be equal to d or larger than that. If d is positive, this is the case, right? Always the case. If d is positive, you know every y value that you would obtain will be much higher than that value. So in this case, you can see here that this graph will not cut the x-axis. That means you will have no solutions. So what happens when d equals 0? Right, when d is larger than 0. So what happens when let's change the color. What happens when d equals 0? When d equals 0, you know that y minimum will be 0. So it would look like this. It would look like this. This is when d equals to 0. Right. Let's change again. It's quite difficult when you are working with Ubuntu emulators. Right. So I don't know why they don't have this option to directly change the colors instead of going through all the trouble. Okay, so what happens when d is negative? When d is negative, the minimum value should be on this side of the Cartesian plane. So in that case, I'm just going to draw a general form, right? It will look like this. It doesn't mean that function shift this side. I'm just drawing it here because it's easier for you to see it, and it is clear, much clear. So in this case, when d is less than 0. Now you know that when d is less than 0, you will have two roots, right? When d equals 0, just one root. When d is positive, no roots. So this is where we can relate the graphical representation to the type of the roots you obtain, right? Okay, so in order to sketch this quadratic function, you need to know the turning point. Now you know how to find turning point, and in order to find the roots, if they exist, what you have to do is you just have to make this equal to 0, right? So we'll look at it in the next slide. Right. So when this expression becomes 0, that means y equals 0, you will have this. So you take d to the other side, that in that case d becomes negative. Negative d equals to x plus h to the power of square. Then you have to take the square roots of on both sides. Then you are left with here x plus h equals to plus or minus square root of minus d. But I have taken x to the other side. Here in this case h has the sign of the positive mark. So when it is taken to the other side, it becomes negative. Right. So the answer is obtained as like this: minus h plus or minus square root of minus d. As I have shown you earlier, when d is negative, what happens? D is negative. This will be a negative number, and it is when it is multiplied by negative number, the whole thing inside the square root will be positive, which means you have a positive third here. So you have two x solutions, one no solution being plus and the next solution being the negative. Right. So what happens when d equals 0? When d equals 0, you know this term cancels out. You're only left with minus h. So that means just one solution. So what happens when d is positive? When d is positive, the term within inside the square root becomes negative. So in that case, you know that no real solutions exist. what do you call this? The square root of negative 1. You should represent it by I. This is called an imaginary number. This is the basis of imaginary numbers. And this does not belong to real numbers. Right? So we will learn about this when we are dealing with complex numbers at the end of grade 30. That means after 2 years. So x will only have real roots when j is either negative or 0. Okay, now we have found the minimum point or the vertex, and then you have found the roots as well. Right. Now it is quite easier to draw or sketch a graph, because the intercept is not quite often necessary to sketch a graph. If you know these 3 points, let's say you have some point here, vertex, and some the roots, then you can easily sketch a quadratic function. Right. So I have mentioned here some examples here. You can see here that when d is negative, here d equals to minus 10. You can see here that it cuts at 2 point. When d is positive, you know it has shifted upwards by 10 units. Actually, not 10 units. Not 10 units. Actually, it cuts at 19 here. We'll discuss this in discussion later. It has shifted upwards towards the positive end of positive sides of the y-axis, leaving you with no roots. This does not cut the x-axis, right? In this case, you have 2 roots, but in this case, no roots. Right. So now we know how the function behaves when the sign of this d changes. Right. So now you need to know this. Usually, you are given this form: ax squared plus bx plus c. This is the form you are given. So in order to find the turning point, especially you have to turn this form into this form, right? Y equals x plus h squared plus d. This is one of the most simplest cases. Notice this, that the coefficient of x equals 1 here, right? So this is the simplest case. The most general case would be y equals ax plus, not a, let me replace this by something else. Y equals, let me just say this, square root of a plus x plus h squared plus a. Okay. Let's call it the general form for the moment. We'll look into details later. Now, how do you turn this, how do you turn the general form into this? So it's quite easy. There are 2 methods that you can perform this, but the first method is quite the easiest way, the fast way to do this. So you have to remember a certain procedure in order to do this. Right. First of all, you just make, this is the simplest case, make sure that the coefficient of x squared is 1. Right. The coefficient of x squared is 1. So what happens when the coefficient of x squared is not 1? Let's say this is ax squared. This is ax squared plus bx plus c. What I'm going to do is I'm going to factor out a from this expression. So we are left with x squared plus, this becomes b over a, x plus c over a. Okay, so now you can deal with this instant, right? Turn this into this form. Right. So how do you do this? If, let's say you have it in this form, what you do, you just put a parenthesis like this and make it square. That's what you do first. Then you input x here. Then you put the sign between x squared and x terms in the middle, right? So if it is minus sign, you should put minus sign here. Then you take this term and take the half of it, right? B divided by 2 and put it here. Take the Okay, then what you do is, so this is the form that we are looking at. Let's see what happens if we put x plus b by 2. No, let's look at an example here. That'd be easier. Don't worry about this just yet. We'll look at an example. This is just something you could remember, or you could just get used to the procedure instead. We'll look at an example. Then it will be quite easy. Right. This is an example. So first, what you do is, you put x, take x here, then take the sign as well, plus. Then you half this and put here. So whatever you write here, this should be equal to the original form. Right? That is the logic. Right? You cannot write something else. Now, let's see whether we can recover. So what is the expansion of this form? If you leave it at this, something will happen. So what is the expansion? Expansion leaves you with x squared plus x into 3 into 2. That leaves you with 6x plus 3 square, that leaves you with 9. Oh. So what happens here? You have generated first two terms of the original function safely. You get x squared, good. You get 6x, good. But you get an additional 9, right? But in the original expression, you have 7, right? So what you do instead is that you have to get rid of this 9. Right? Get rid of this 9. Okay. So so I'm gonna write the complete thing now. So x plus 3 squared, you make it into a square expression, right? Then after that you have 7 here, no worries. Now you make sure whether you can recover the original terms. X squared is recovered, 6x is recovered, 7 is recovered, okay, 7 is there, but in addition to that, you get 3 squared, right? So how do you get rid of 3 squared? You just subtract 3 squared, right? That's all you do. So this becomes x plus 3 squared, 7 minus 3 squared means 7 minus 9, that leaves you with minus 2. This is how we do it, y equals x plus 3 squared minus 2. So we'll look at more examples during the discussions, and I believe that you will be get familiarized with this completing square methods, and it will be easier to deal with this form instead of the general form like in this case. Okay, this is the second method actually. We will discuss this during the class. So I'm going to stop this video here. If you have any questions, please refer them to